Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Keisha Rogers, and I'm going to be moderating our forum for today. I'd like to welcome all of you here. I would most certainly like to thank and welcome our distinguished guests today who will be on our panel, will be speaking, and I will introduce them momentarily. And I will also pay some recognitions to some of our guests in the audience as well. But before I do that, let me just give a brief overview as to why we're here today and kind of set the stage a little here. And as many of you know, the Schiller Institute hosting this forum today is hosting the forum under the title of The New Silk Road, Peace Through Development, Peace Through Economic Development. And it's very fitting that people come to understand this conception of what it means to bring about a true peace within the world right now, a true peace through economic development. For those who don't know, the Schiller Institute was founded by Madame Helga Zepp LaRouche, and Mrs. LaRouche has been and her husband working alongside of her, Mr. Lyndon LaRouche, have been long proponents of this conception of economic peace and development, and have actually been promoting this platform of what we know today and what China has played a leading role in of the Belt and Road, New Silk Road development. I will just say that going back to the 1990s, this publication was made in 1997 of January, the Eurasian Land Bridge, the New Silk Road Locomotive for Worldwide Economic Development. And this was the starting point many decades ago of the platform of corridors of economic development connecting Eurasia, Europe, and Asia through the Land Bridge Initiative. And since the publication of this report, we have published a number of other reports, including one which I would like to show just a short clip to give you a sense of the decades-long work and what we are now currently in the middle of with the promotion of the Belt and Road Initiative and the New Silk Road. So if we can play that clip, it's just about 4 minutes here. And then I'll go on to introducing our speakers.
We are right now, as a civilization, at a crossroad where the future fate of mankind is completely open. We still could end up in a world war, a global world war, which would lead to the extinction of civilization. The conflict right now, which exists very clearly between the Atlantic sector, especially the United States and the European Union on the one side, and the BRICS countries, which are going for the New Silk Road and the World Land Bridge, it has everything to do with the image of man.
The old system of government, the idea of the nation-state system, the old idea of the nation-state system is now dead. Or it's ready to die at any moment. But what's actually happening with the BRICS function, what the significance of the BRICS as an institutional approach, means that the old system of economy, of national economy, is dead. Because what's happened is that the nations are forming institutional structures, as in South America, for example, in the BRICS there, in India, and so forth. These are new institutions which have no consistency with the old traditional institutions of government. And what you're seeing in the BRICS relationship is actually the idea of a planetary system, and that's what's happening with what China is doing in terms of what they're doing on the moon. In other words, the moon, the lunar operation by China is leading the way or marking the way to a new system on the planet.
Now, therefore, we have to define the present from the standpoint of the future, because we already can see now what mankind will be capable of in the coming hundreds and thousands of years, and that we are still in the embryonic phase of civilization, and that, you know, we must become adult now.
The nation-state system will have a reflection, but the reflection will be different. It will not be separate interests. It will be complementary interests, as we're seeing in the BRICS, for example. The world is ready for the complementary interest of a world, no longer the competition of nation states as such. It's over. But the essential function of nations, the human species, is going to be different than it ever was before.
This new report, the title of which is The New Silk Road Becomes the World Land Bridge, is a very exciting, completely new platform for the cooperation among nations. And I think I'm not saying too much to promise you that in the very near future, every government and every parliament of the world will discuss this, because this will be the item nobody can go around. It is a completely optimistic outline of how the world can get out of the present crisis and go into a completely new era of civilization.
Just so people know, we do have these reports at our back table that you're welcome to obtain there, and to the Silk Road Becomes the World Land Bridge. And then also, we've been very busy, and we also have a new report that has just been published a few months ago, very recently, extending the New Silk Road to West Asia and Africa, a vision of an economic renaissance. This report can also be found in the back. So, and I'd just like to just conclude on this with, again, making the point that was made by founder chairwoman of the Show Institute, Mrs. LaRouche, at a recent conference called Ibero-America, titled The Belt and Road Vision to Create a Mass Movement for Development, that the New Silk Road spirit is a very powerful new dynamic in the world, as she says. As a matter of fact, it is already the dominating tendency of the whole globe, in which 140 countries are already participating. So, and we want to make sure that the United States and other nations rapidly are emerged into this beautiful new paradigm. So with that, I'd just like, without forgetting, first of all, to recognize that we are on a very special day that we're holding this conference and this forum today. As many of you know, we are commemorating the 50th anniversary of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And I think this forum is quite fitting for what Dr. King stood for as one who promoted an end to a system of violence, of war, of poverty, of geopolitics, as we would call it today. And, you know, he asked in one of his final books, where do we go from here, chaos or community? And that Dr. King made very clear that the promotion of peace through economic development very much relied on the ending of poverty. And I believe that the nations of the BRICS nations, that the win-win cooperation that has been promoted by China, in which 140 nations have joined, this is the intention right now, to put a end to poverty once and for all. And as Dr. King once said in what he titled The World House, all inhabitants of the globe are now neighbors. This worldwide neighbor has been brought into being largely as a result of the modern scientific and technological revolutions. But he goes on to discuss why it is in the interest of mankind to put an end to poverty once and for all, that it has no place in our day and age. So with that, let me go ahead and introduce our speakers here. And we will be taking questions from the audience later. Just give me one second. Before I introduce our speakers, just in case, just to make note, there are some distinguished guests in the audience with us today, representing various consulates, and I'd like to recognize them, and then I will address and introduce our speakers. One moment, please. First of all, we have the representative from Indonesia, Vice Council of Economic Affairs, Vice Council Habsari, is here today with us. And we also have, is Mr. Khan right here? Yes, okay, Mr. Khan. He's the Energy Council of the Consul General of Turkey, who is here today with us. And she was here, I'm not sure if she's here, but we also have representing the Council of Russia, Mr. Dmitry Politkin. Thank you very much for being here. Okay. So with that, and if there's anyone else that I've missed, please forgive me. Please introduce yourselves. But otherwise, let's go ahead and move forward with our speakers for today. The first speaker that I'd like to introduce to you is the Honorable Consul General Aisha Faruqi, who will be speaking to us. Let me just give a bio of her for today. Consul General Faruqi, Ms. Faruqi, is the Consul General from Pakistan to the U.S. She was born in Karachi, Pakistan, and is fluent in French, English, and Urdu. She also has mediated between peoples and cultures and countries as a diplomat of Pakistan since 1994. Ms. Faruqi has served in several important capitals abroad in her long and diverse diplomatic career. She has also contributed towards policymaking at important political desks in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Islamabad, and she Well, I'm just saying that there can be much more that can be said about Consul General Faruqi and her very impressive professional experience, including the fact that she served as Minister and Deputy Head of Mission of Pakistan Embassy in Ankara, Turkey, and much more. So she's also been a delegate to a number of conferences around the world. So without further ado, we are very honored today to have Consul General Faruqi with us, to speak with us. So if you would please, thank you.
Good afternoon and greetings to the distinguished audience. A big thank you to Mr. Brian Lance and the Schiller Institute for inviting me here today and giving me an opportunity to talk about the Belt and Road Initiative from Pakistan's perspective. My presentation is going to be in two parts. In the first part, I'm going to give a very short overview of Pakistan's domestic situation and the economy, and then on the PowerPoint presentation, I will take a more detailed look at the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which is one of the flagship projects under the Belt and Road Initiative of the Chinese government. So, for those who do not know Pakistan very well, I want to start out with a brief historical overview. Pakistan belongs to an ancient civilization that stretches back almost 7 millennia. It is the land of Gandhara, of Harappa, of Mohenjo-daro, and Mehergarh, which are some of the most ancient and important Neolithic sites in archaeology in the world that date back between 2500 BC to 7000 BC. But Pakistan, the nation state, is only 70 years old, which is considered to be a mere blip in the life cycle of nation states. It is home to almost 200 million people and ranked the sixth largest country in the world. 60% of our people are under 30 years of age. It has a rapidly expanding middle class of 50 to 60 million educated and well-traveled citizens with a purchasing power equal to many in Central Asia and in East Europe. Pakistan in the last few years has had a consistent growth in its GDP, which is expected to reach over 6% at the end of 2018. Over the past 3 years, fiscal deficit has declined from 8.6 to 4.2%, while tax to GDP ratio has also increased from 9.8 to 12.4%, and investment to GDP ratio from 14.9 to 15.2%. Inflation has been contained at under 3% presently, while the industrial sector has registered a growth of 6.8% during the past 2 years and is poised to do even better at the end of 2018. Credit rating agencies like Moody's, Standard & Poor's have rated Pakistan's economy positively, while PricewaterhouseCoopers has recently placed Pakistan at 20 in its ranking of projected list of 32 most powerful economies of the world by 2030. Pakistan today is home to over 1,000 foreign companies who have invested in Pakistan and are doing profitable business through their Pakistan franchise. The stock exchange, the Pakistan Stock Exchange, is booming. Recently, 40% of its strategic shares were sold to a Chinese consortium. While consumer market in Pakistan is also growing at a fast pace in sectors such as automobiles, housing, electronics, telecommunication, hospitality industry, and online retail. In recent years, ladies and gentlemen, Pakistan has emerged as an expanding market for American and European products, as well as becoming a destination of interest for for foreign investors in the power sector, oil and gas, telecommunications, and financial sectors. Added to this domestic economic strength is the significant advantage that we expect to accrue as a result of our strategic economic partnership with China. So moving on to our PowerPoint presentation now. As I said, the land of Pakistan, since ancient times, has been a gateway for travelers and traders. Pakistan is fully cognizant of the importance of regional connectivity for peace, stability, and economic progress. It offers a critical overland and maritime routes for trade and energy connectivity within the region and far beyond. Next, please. The China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, or CPEC, as it is popularly known, is a flagship project of China's One Belt and One Road initiative by President Xi Jinping. This is the heritage and ethos of our region, which is being reaffirmed and resurrected through the CPEC. Its success will shape the 21st century model of peaceful economic and trade cooperation. And it holds the potential to be a game changer, not just for Pakistan, but for the whole region. CPEC epitomizes the spirit and strength of Pakistan-China friendship and cooperation for regional peace, progress, and prosperity. It is a framework for regional connectivity, which has the potential of transforming the region by developing synergies across geographic regions, across energy routes, and across trading links in a region that spans China, South and West Asia, and Central Asia. It seeks to build ever-expanding circles of win-win cooperation schemes, stability and peace, extending from Pakistan and China to Eurasia and Africa. Just to share a quote made by the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Shahid Khaqan Abbasi, recently at the World Economic Forum in Davos, he said, I quote, "We strongly recognize the vision of China and President Xi. We believe the Belt and Road Initiative is perfectly in sync with the WEF theme of creating shared future in a fractured world. It is much more than just a partnership on infrastructure, and it will cause significant improvement in lives of people from different countries," unquote. Just to encapsulate the significance and potential that CPEC offers, under this, there are four key areas envisaged with an estimated investment of approximately $46 billion. These include the Gwadar port investment, approximately with an investment of $793 million. Infrastructure and energy with an investment of $34 billion. Transportation infrastructure, under which $6.1 billion is earmarked for roads network and $3.7 billion for the rail network. And the fourth is industrial cooperation between the two sides. The corridor is about 3,000 kilometers long, consisting of highways, railways, and pipelines that will connect China's Xinjiang province to the rest of the world through the Gwadar port. CPEC is poised to completely transform logistics as the container ships that today have to make the nearly 13,000 kilometer sea voyage from Tianjin to the Persian Gulf through the Strait of Malacca and around India. This will be replaced by cheaper container trucks that will make a mere 2,000 kilometer road journey from Kashgar to Gwadar. That is the promise of this project. This project hopes to foster diverse investment opportunities, such as industrial cooperation, cooperation in finance, in agriculture, tourism, education, human resource development, healthcare, people-to-people contact, as well as enhance security and stability of the entire region. I'd like to identify four key areas that are the pillars upon which this project is anchored. The first is connectivity. Connectivity, as we all know, is the cornerstone of development. It increases the flow of goods, information, and people across regions. It seeks to upgrade transport infrastructure through CPEC to improve not only inter, but also intra-connectivity between Pakistan and China. Thus, an integrated transport system is central to the long-term plan under CPEC. And then I have listed several projects that enhance and strengthen the road network within Pakistan and those leading into China. Next, please. Our next important area for development is information technology, which is critical for development. For this purpose, a cross-border optical fiber cable system has been laid between Pakistan and China, and both sides have agreed to cooperate in promoting technologies of the fourth industrial revolution in Pakistan. Our third area is cooperation in the energy sector, where both countries have agreed to enhance cooperation in the field of oil and gas, electricity, and power grids. Also agreed between the two sides is to focus on thermal power, hydropower, coal gasification, and renewable power generation, along with modernization of the power transmission network within Pakistan. So far, over 11,000 megawatt energy has been added to the national grid in Pakistan, the bulk of which comes through CPEC investments. In the realm of industry, the project envisages to build an industrial base in Pakistan through establishing new industrial parks and special economic zones. Both countries have agreed to cooperate to improve and strengthen the textile and garment industry, modernize agriculture, engineering industry, as well as emphasize to improve the incomes of small farmers by increasing their productivity and efficiency. Another very important sector that is ripe for development through the CPEC is to build coastal tourism along the Arabian Sea in the southwest of Pakistan. As Gwadar, you may know, lies on the Arabian Sea in the southwest of Pakistan. And I have some maps further down that will give you a clearer visual of what it is. Another key area where cooperation is taking place between the two sides is in monetary cooperation. And cooperation and closer ties between the central banks of the two countries. Both countries have also agreed on bilateral currency swap arrangements, leading to payments in yuan and rupees for CPEC projects. Next, please. I want to give you a little... Next, please. Yes. So this map gives you the terrain, the map of Pakistan. And the road networks that are, some are under construction. This is both short-term and long-term. I don't know if you can see very clearly, but the orange line show road works, which are a priority under the CPEC. The red lines indicate short-term projects that are underway. And the light blue indicate highways that connect Pakistan to China in the north. Next, please. The next map gives a visual on the enhancement of not only the existing railway network within Pakistan, but also creation of new tracks and connections that lead to the north of Pakistan and into the bordering areas in China. Next, please. The third slide gives a sketch of the fiber optic network that has been laid in the north of Pakistan primarily to ensure connectivity through the northern areas of Pakistan, Karimabad, Gilgit, Punjab, where the KKH passes from Pakistan into China. Next, please. Here are some visuals on the other projects that are already underway. So this is the Sahiwal coal-fired power plant. These are two projects, two plants, 660 megawatt each. Sahiwal lies in the center of Pakistan. These are all under CPEC. The next one gives you a visual on the construction that's taking place to connect Karachi, which is in the south of the country, to Lahore, and then onwards to the north of the country. So the new motorway is being constructed with the help of our Chinese friends. The next slide gives an idea of the under construction coal fire power project in Port Qasim, which is another port in the south of Pakistan, just off Karachi. Next, please. As part of the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, Gwadar holds a pivotal importance. The port of Gwadar is a hub of connectivity for the corridor and an indispensable interchange for the Silk Route. With an investment of $793 million for Gwadar Port, it is envisaged to become, in the years ahead, an important conduit for trade and energy transactions between China and Central Asia on the one hand, and the Indian Ocean region and continents of Africa and Europe on the other hand. Next, please. Development of Gwadar Port City. Okay, we have some visuals here of a few projects that are taking place in Gwadar. This is the Gwadar East Bay Expressway. Pertaining to development of Gwadar City, both countries are actively promoting the East Bay Expressway project and the new Gwadar International Airport. Work is also underway to develop the Gwadar Smart Port City Master Plan. Efforts are also being taken to improve the social development, socio-economic development of the local population in education, healthcare, and primary school, as well as water desalination plants. Next, please. These are some of the pictures of ongoing projects. Next, please. This is the business center envisaged under the Smart Port City Master Plan. Next, please. Okay, talking about the long-term plan, the implementation of CPEC is envisaged in three phases. The first phase, which is likely to culminate by 2020, the socio-economic development is to be focused upon and addressed. In the second phase, envisaged to be completed by 2025, infrastructure development and industrial projects will remain the focus. In the third phase of the long-term plan, slated to mature by 2030, CPEC's role in stimulating economic growth in Central Asia and South Asia is focused, which we hope would result in the creation of an international economic zone that has far-reaching impact. And that brings me to the end of my presentation.
There was a slide regarding the monetary that was only shown for a millisecond. And could we go back to that, because I'd like to see that.
Monetary cooperation?
Yes, please.
Speaker, which is Deputy Consul General from the Republic of China, People's Republic of China, Dr. Wang. And Dr. Wang will, let me just give a brief introduction of him. he was a graduate in 2001 from Beijing University and with a doctorate's degree in international politics. The same year, he started his career in the Chinese Ministry of Foreign Affairs, with a focus on China, U.S., China-United States bilateral relations. Dr. Wong worked in the Department of North American and Oceanic Affairs, the Chinese Embassy to the United States, and the General Office of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And in, from June 2017, Dr. Wong has served as Deputy Consul General and Deputy Chief of Missions of the Chinese Consulate General in Houston. He is married and he has a daughter. So without further ado, we will have Mr. Wong come and speak with us.
Madam Rogers, thank you so much for introduction. Brian, and the comrades, friends from the Schiller Institute, it's really my pleasure to receive your invitation and my honor indeed to share the floor with Madam Consul General from Pakistan. Well, just as Madam Rogers mentioned, today is really a special day. It's the commemoration of the 50th anniversary of the assassination of a very important figure, not only in the United States, but also in the world affairs. I think today's event is a good commemoration of what he has done to improve the quality among peoples, among various ethnic groups. Well, just now, Consul General has made a very detailed, accurate, vivid, and very inspiring analysis of China-Pakistan economic corridor. Actually, I learned a lot from that. And just right now, wondering whether it is available at Amazon as well. So I'd like to purchase on your PPT in order to show the respect for your IPR. Yeah. Well, today I'd like to make a review of the Belt and the Road Initiative because it was put forward by President Xi 5 years ago. It's going to be a little bit general as well as panoramic about what we are doing, about what we are thinking about. Let's begin. Yeah. Well, yes, as I mentioned, it's an initiative put forward by our president. Pay attention to the diction here. Initiative instead of a program, instead of a regime, something like that. So we will, I will explain a little bit later. Well, in 2013, during his respective visits to Kazakhstan and Indonesia, President Xi put forward this important initiative. Why did President Xi choose these two countries to make public this initiative? I will explain it later, because these two countries are just on the Silk Road, traditional Silk Road, as well as the maritime Silk Road. They are very important countries to cooperate. Well, Pakistan is even more important, I should point out. Yes, please. Well, ABCD of the initiative, trying to provide you with a panoramic point of view of the initiative. Well, A represents A Tale of Two Roads. So I just got the inspiration of a coinage from A Tale of Two Cities. It's a tale of two roads. One is the Silk Road. Well, I assume that everybody has got some knowledge about the traditional Silk Road. Well, you know, it has related with a very important exploration led by China's most successful diplomat, traveler, as well as explorer, Zhang Qian, dated back to 2,000 years ago. you see that guy. He led us a very imaginative, dynamic business trip from central China through Eurasia, including your esteemed country, Pakistan, to Iran. It's a very long road, long route, and also a long story, a successful story. Well, today, we Chinese people are still benefiting from this road. Every day, we would like to have the tomatoes. And in China, we call it xihongshi. It means something we bought from something that was bought and funded from the West world. So it's very successful, and it was still, you know, it has a very historic significance on China's outlook on the world, on its relations with the other regions, especially with the neighboring regions. So, next one. And another one is the Maritime Silk Road. Well, in the year 1405, from the year 1405 to 1433, another guy named Zheng He, yeah, he led the business vessel, a huge fleet, from east part of China through the southeast to the east part of Africa. You see, Kenya. And this guy was courageous enough because he was meeting many unprecedented challenges on the Maritime Silk Road. Well, it was as successful as Zhang Qian's Silk Road because right now, yeah, we can move on to the next one. You see, there are dotted spots, countries, where the Chinese people had left their footprints. Actually, these two stories have given us much inspiration as to how to interpret, how to understand the history, and how to get inspiration from our past successful experience. Yeah, please. Sorry, let's go back a little bit. Well, let's summarize the success of the two roads. That is, we can summarize it by no trade war, no slave trade, and no colonization. So this is really something different by our Chinese practice from some Western colonists in the coming years. So these three ones we should bear in mind. That's our legacy, that's our story, yes. Well, besides the historical background, let's look at the current world. How to understand the world situation in a globalized way. Yeah, we would like to define the background against which the Belt and Road Initiative was initiated. Well, we live in a world of globalization. I think we need to have two words added to describe it. That's an era of globalization, of information and turmoil. First, how to understand turmoil is the imbalance, development, it's the equality, it's the impoverishment. It looks like a dark future, but everybody, I think, at present must have some sort of understanding of it. Imbalance. Even in China, different regions enjoy different, you know, development stages. Right now, we do have the developed countries as well as developing countries, and the gap between the development stage is still widening. And equality, you know, even here in the States, it's needless to stress that only a small number of people can occupy a large sum of money. So that's the inequality. Impoverishment, look at those people in the center part of Eurasia as well as people in the Sahara, as impoverishment. Even in China, after 40 years of high-speed development, we still have a very severe challenge of getting people out of poverty. There are still 22 million people who really need, you know, the government help, as well as the specific organizations. So it's a very challenging task to every one of us. Yeah, please. Another one is how to look at the world from the strategist's point of view. Well, I would cite two examples. One is from Dr. Henry Kissinger. He defines the world situation in his world order as, to quote, new ways of assessing and communicating information unite the regions as never before and project events globally. That's end quote. That's his words. And you see that old town guy? I met him. I was accompanying our Minister of Foreign Affairs in New York, and Dr. Henry Kissinger was telling me something about how he looked at the new world, unbalanced world, really his world order. Another one is the late Dr. Brinsky. He's really a strategist, especially in terms of geopolitics. And he sees Eurasia as the heartland of the world. He stresses the importance of stability and peace in Eurasia. So these are the views from two most prominent US strategists. Yes, go on, please. Well, look at the future, we can understand that why China is trying to push ahead the Belt and Road Initiative. Well, we have the challenge. We have the advantages to cope with the challenges. China, nowadays, we do have some advantages, and we have to share with other countries to cope with the challenges. One is, let me cite the most important ones. One is China's GDP, exceeded $10 trillion in 2014, and China became the second largest world economy in 2010. And right now, in 2017, China's GDP exceeded more than $12 trillion. And China's manufacturing already number one in the world. Yes, that's the basic advantages, some of them I'd like to highlight. And Asia, as infrastructure demand is huge. Asia needs, 730 billion US dollars in terms of infrastructure investment, and China has the world's largest foreign currency reserve. So that's another advantage. Yeah, please. So we put forward the initiative in an area of including more than 60 countries, covering 30% of the world's land area, 60% of the world's population. The whole GDP accounts for 30% of the world's total. So that's an area perspective. Yeah. Well, so far, we have the background, we have the advantages, and what shall we do, and what shall we implement the initiative? As Consul General mentioned, the key word is connectivity. Yeah. Well, we do have five pronged approaches covering trade, politics, people-to-people exchange, investment, so on and so forth. So policy coordination, I think the China-Pakistan economic corridor is a good result of two countries' policy coordination. And we will have the connectivity of this infrastructure. As I mentioned earlier, Asia has a very huge demand for the infrastructure, not only in Asia, but also the Eurasia areas and even worldwide. Because in China, you have the proverb, if you somebody wants to get rich, one needs to build the road first. So infrastructure, importance of it, is needless to emphasize. And we have the unimpeded trade. You know, different tariffs, trade barriers will hamper the free flow of trade and investment. So we need to reduce the trade barriers. And we have the financial integration. Actually, we set up the AIIB, Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, so as to provide more financial support to the initiative and closer people-to-people ties. So it aims at keep the factors flowing freely and in a mutual beneficial way. The key word is connectivity, because we are now living in a world that nobody can be isolated. So we need to inject more impetus to the free flowing of personnel, trade, investment, people-to-people understanding, something like that, yes. Well, to summarize a little bit on this part, I think there are four principles which guide the initiative. One is openness. Even though I mentioned the 16 countries, actually no country is excluded from that. Even the US is not in the Eurasia area. It is welcome to have some joint cooperations in the third countries between China and the US. So it's open, nobody is excluded. And we stress, another one is, we stress the harmony and inclusiveness. It means everybody should treat each other equal, and we are not imposing something on the other countries. It's the initiative, it's not a binding treaty. Right. And market-based cooperation, since it's an initiative, it's going to be market-oriented, it's going to be market-based and market-result. So mutual benefits, it aims at providing the local people with more jobs, increase the free flow of trade investment, improve the situation in Eurasia, delivering more benefits to the local peoples along the two roads. Yes, that's the principles. Yes, please. So, somebody would like to compare, make a comparison between the Belt and Road Initiative and the Marshall Plan. Now I mentioned that there are huge differences against different backgrounds, and we are now living in a different world. It's a little bit, I don't think it's of much significance and meaning to discuss the difference or similarities among these two important plans. But let me summarize a little bit. It's initiative. This one is for cooperation and development. Yeah. It aims to developing infrastructure and trade connectivity, builds on the existing bilateral and multilateral institutions rather than replacing them. No block confrontation. Yes, there were NATO and Warsaw during which the period when the Marshall Plan was ushering. But right now, we do not like the block confrontation. It aims at nobody, right? And no attached political struggles. We're dealing with countries of very various developing stages, no matter whether, no matter the faiths, the religions, the ethnic groups, and different social systems. And no interference with regional countries' internal affairs, no severe influence, no seeking for predominance. So it's an initiative. It aims at providing more tangible benefits to the local people. It's not, politicize this initiative. Yes, long enough or likely to survive, it depends on how many dividends, what kind of dividends you can deliver to the people. So I would like to summarize what we have achieved in the past year, 2017. Well, first we have the first Belt and Road Forum for International Cooperation, is BRF. Well, more than 29 heads of state attended this forum. It marks the establishment of the official international dialogue mechanism at the highest level under the BRF frame. And next year we will hold another international forum on this topic. The aim is at the highest level to stress the importance of policy coordination, strengthen the understanding, mutual understanding of how each country's developing strategies could be adopted with each other. So that's our main purpose. Again, it's not the bloc politics. We are not, you know, inviting somebody to foster a new bloc. That's not true. Well, another one, please. Thank you. Well, development in 2017. Practical results. Only in the year 2017, 50 newly signed agreements between China and the other related countries, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor and China-Europe Express Train. These are two huge successful stories for the initiative in 2017. Madam Consul General has provided us with a very beautiful point about the corridor, so I will not go into details about that. And 19 new national foreign trade and economic cooperation zones in four countries along the route. So we are pushing ahead the infrastructure construction. We are, with the concerted efforts from the other parties, setting up more national economic zones in order to facilitate the trade, in order to enjoy some advantageous policies within the country. So it's a good, it has been a successful story in China. We are still benefiting a lot from the national economic zones, and we hope that under the initiative, there could be more national economic zones set up with individual countries. Of course, with the consent, with the concerted efforts from the related parties. Yes, please. And financial cooperation, additional 100 million RMB invested in the Silk Road Fund. And we have the AIIB. Right now there are more than 70 countries within the AIIB. And the multilateral financial cooperation, 16 plus 1, as China's financial cooperation with the Central European countries, is a huge development. In the Central and Eastern Europe, people's demands for infrastructure investment for the economic zones set up are huge, and they bear back the financial support. So, and for some prospects in 2018, according to, we can look at the prospect into different perspectives. One is according to UN World Economic Situation and Prospects in 2018, the economic prospects of countries along the Belt and Road Initiative are expected well. So we really expect rather stable development, economic development, generally speaking, along the countries along the routes. And well, there is another side of the coin. That's the politics, especially terrorism, extremism, and populism. You know, they are right now on the rising trend. And we have the, we are facing the different, still the different attitude towards the Belt and Road Initiative. Some people are still wondering what's the real intentions. What are the real intentions behind the initiative? And is China still trying to create a pursuing a predominant role in Eurasia? Is China trying to drive US out of certain regions? So strategic suspicions are still there. Yes. Yeah, plans in 2018 is the cooperation mechanism, still the joint committee of China-US Economic Corridor. I want to highlight some of them. China-Nepal Economic Corridor, China-Myanmar Economic Corridor. So economic corridors are now the highlights of the Belt and Road Initiative. And Russia and Northeast Asia. Russia is, right now having the Euro-Asia Economic Union. That's Russia's national strategy in terms of economic development. And we are adopting the Belt and Road Initiative with Russia's strategy on that. And South Korea also has its own strategy, while we are making the adoptions as well. And the financial support, STU, AIIB, and Silk Road Fund are developing at a very fast speed. So I don't think financial support is a big challenge to each and every party. And number four is promote understanding and enhance cultural bonds. Actually, it should be cultural and social bonds. So we are not only aiming at promoting and enhancing the infrastructure constructions only. We are also putting more into the social understanding, people-to-people exchange, so as to create a better environment for the initiative. That's equally important. Yes. Now, let's have something relaxing. It's two posters, very hot. It really looked like the Hollywood thrillers, don't they? Actually, these are two posters. The Chinese view, very hot indeed. One is the warring wolf setting, and another one is the cooperation in the Red Sea. It's fiction. It's fiction. But what I display them right here is simply that I like to stress that China is firmly going in and going global. It's written in our constitution. There will be more Chinese enterprises abroad, especially along the Belt and Road Initiative, along the good countries. So we will face more challenges abroad, especially in terms of terrorism, fundamentalism, something like that, and of course trade protectionism as well. But we are resolute, we are determined to cooperate with the other countries. We are determined to integrate China's economy into the regionalization. So this is the general direction, and even though we will face a lot of severe challenges. Yes, please. Well, everybody must be interested in the prospect of China-US cooperation under the initiative. In Obama's administration, there were a lot of hard discussions about the initiative. And right now we have the new administration, and last year for the International Forum on the initiative, the White House sent a very high-ranking official attending the forum, showcasing that United States is playing more, attaching more importance to this initiative. We hope that in the third countries and regions, China and U.S. could make full use of their advantages so as to deliver more benefits to the local people as well as to the two countries. There are suspicions as well, but the Chinese side is open, is confident, and is patient, because we think that cooperation under the initiative between China and the U.S. serves the fundamental interests of our two great nations. So that's the general principle. Yes. Now we come to the end of my presentation. Thank you. so much for your patience.
Okay, so our final speaker is going to be Mr. Brian Lance, representing the International Shiller Institute. And just to say a few words on a friend here, Mr. Lance is the founding member, one of the founding members of the International Shiller Institute. He's worked for 45 years. He has been a writer and policy activist and researcher. He also, throughout his career, has been a collaborator for many years with statesmen, U.S. statesmen, and economist Lyndon LaRouche. He's recently wrote for the Executive Intelligence Review a report. He published the first comprehensive overview of Mayor Turner's delegation, his December 2017 trade mission to China. So he will be speaking to us more on that. And without further ado, let me just go ahead and introduce to you Mr. Brian Lance. Thank you.
Thank you. So first of all, I just want to stress the enormity of the New Silk Road, Belt and Road Initiative. This is an enormous transformation that's underway. For those who may not be figures, I mean, you know, trillion here, a trillion here in these things, but over $1 trillion equivalent has been committed so far into the Belt and Road. On the order of 650, 750 billion a year are going to be invested in this overall project over the coming years, into the 2020s. Not just from China, but from Pakistan, from other nations, an enormous effort which really transforms, you know, it will transform the map of the world. And that's already underway, Gwadar Port. I mean, these are established projects. We were just getting a report earlier today of the transformation of the west coast of Africa with major port projects up and down, Angola and on up into up to Nigeria and beyond, going up the coast. You have competition in Europe, Portugal, Spain. They want to not only be centerpieces of the Belt and Road, but they want to be the link between the Belt and Road and countries like Brazil, right, which is historically Portuguese. They want to be the link to the countries in Africa that they have a shared past with, transforming that relationship. Right now, across Eurasia, thousands of train sets every year are moving back and forth, moving goods, services, ideas across Eurasia. So this really is a transformation for mankind that's underway. And China's initiative, the Belt and Road Initiative, as Dr. Wong emphasized, as an open-ended, they put this out, and it's growing, and it's expanding. Now it's reached the Americas. And I don't think that's among the 60 nations or 70. You know, you're getting up into the 140s or the number of nations is increasing. There was just recently the China CELAC summit in Santiago, Chile, as I said, in late January. This was high level. This is 33 governments represented there. Most of them were at the foreign ministry level, but foreign ministers were there. And there was agreement on the Belt and Road as the way forward for the development of the Caribbean, the development of South America, Central America. Panama has now become a major hub for the Belt and Road. Obviously, the Panama Canal expanded exists, but now there's port development, rail development. Panama's committed and China companies in collaboration are building now a railroad up to the border of Costa Rica. The idea is then to take that railroad all the way up, you know, through Mexico and eventually into the United States. And of course, you could go south from there as well. You could cross the Darien Gap eventually. The point is that this process of building out, if you could go to the, well, we have it up there already, we're really building out a world land bridge, as we emphasized when we published our report in 2015, inspired by China's initiative, and also from our earlier work, looking at the world from the top down. If you probably have figured it out by now, at the very top there is the Aleutian Straits, the Bering Straits rather, and that link will be part of what finalizes a link of the land masses of the world. A point to be made here on this, and the China-Pakistan economic corridor is a perfect example. As we were talking about the other day, these corridors are corridors of development. Think of the Transcontinental Railroad across the United States. The Transcontinental Railroad was a railroad that opened up the entire center, the guts of the United States as a continent, for settlement, for cities, for resource development. Along the railroad, product was transformed. It started out in one form. By the time it got to the other end, it could be something completely different. You know, value added, as they say these days, along the way. And so you had the development of the United States. And that was undertaken, it's worth reminding ourselves, that was undertaken during the Civil War. Despite the enormous expenditures of lives and resources in the Civil War, the Transcontinental Railroad was launched by President Abraham Lincoln in that period, and it was carried forward and completed after his untimely death. So these corridors mean that we're moving away from the coastlines, you know, where civilization historically has been, whether you're talking about coast of China, coast of the United States, Europe. You're opening up. You're creating, if you will, man-made rivers through the continents themselves, right? Which then become part of developing civilization. So I just want to feature that. Go to the next slide. I want to just kind of bring this back home to Houston here briefly. This is walking along the berm there. You know, this is during Harvey, right? And you can kind of ask yourself, well, which side is holding back the water from where? Because, you know, it's everywhere. Going to the next slide. As most of you know, this dates from the 1940s. We built these projects. You see, Attucks Reservoir, Barker Reservoir. This was the original Army Corps of Engineers plan from that time for building out infrastructure for a city, which was a fraction of its population now. But even then, you see the Southern Canal, you see a Northern Canal to move water out of the area and out to Galveston Bay, right? This was part of it. Now up here is the Cypress Creek levee that was proposed. That was never built, which is part of the reason why Attucks and Barker ran into, you know, basically overreached their possibilities for holding back water. But that's now being talked about as building a new reservoir up there. Well, that's fine and dandy, but that's a small part of what's going to be needed. Next slide, please. I just want to give a sense. This is just the topography of the state of Texas. Notice it goes from high to down low, down to the coastline. Go to the next slide. These are the rivers. They all go down here, and they all drain out in one place. And we know what that resulted in with the rainfall that Harvey generated. But this is what has to be addressed. In other words, we finally have to address here the necessity of major infrastructure on the scale of the North-South Water Project in China, of the Three Gorges, of the Grand Coulee, Columbia River system, of the TVA system, a modern equivalent of that that's going to have to be done if the Gulf area isn't just going to basically shrivel up and die. Go on to the next. This is the Ike Dyke, proposed Ike Dyke. To prevent, besides rainfall, of course, we have to prevent storm surge. Hurricanes bringing in a 40, 50 foot storm surge would completely wipe out our refinery capacity in the whole area. But these projects are hundreds of billions of dollars. This is not small potatoes. To actually encompass the problem from a scientific and engineering standpoint, from the top down, you can't do this piecemeal by financing the removal of a few homes and telling everybody they got to jack their houses up 3 feet. You know, this is not going to do it, or simply a reservoir here or there. Move on here. And it's a national crisis. This is the Society of Civil Engineers, American Society of Civil Engineers report card. Go on to the next. And that's how the country rates as a whole. D pluses, Ds, you know, you get the idea. Ports are among the better of what we've got in terms of capacities. And they're being very conservative. This is, you know, engineers are generally very conservative, a lot of people. Move on to the next. So in other words, what is being done is, for example, with the Pakistan, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, is what we have to think of in terms of, we have to think big again. We have to think outside the box. Think of Franklin Roosevelt. Think of John F. Kennedy, you know, and think of him saying, think of it, you know, perhaps you were alive at the time, alive and more than just being a child. Think of it. He said, we're going to go to the moon before the end of the decade. You know, and we did it. So here's the, you know, the broader sense of what the Belt and Road Initiative is becoming, including into the Americas. I wanted to include the Americas, and this is a map that we developed ourselves, just a schematic. But including the Panama projects and the proposed Nicaragua canal and so forth. Go on to the next. And note Eurasia, well, you see it there, across Eurasia, the Eurasian land bridge, one of the major corridors being developed together with Russia and with Mongolia and with the Eastern European countries, the 16+1 process that China's been involved in with the Eastern European countries. I put this up here in part to just note also a project also being proposed, the Kra Canal in Thailand, which is now back under discussion, not just discussion, but at the government level, this is now moving forward again, which will help solve that problem in terms of the getting across, getting through there from the South China Sea into the Indian Ocean. Opening up that whole process, that logjam there, a very serious one. Also, it's a big piracy problem. I would just mention that the two movie posters that you put up there, the one on the right referencing the Red Sea, that was a movie made about fighting piracy off the coast of Africa, if I recall right. Right? Popular movie in China today. But these problems can be solved through economic development, through transforming these areas. Go on to the next. Here we have the Three Gorges Dam. This is an example. I just want to underscore the extent to which China is transforming itself. But go on to the next. This is a dam that China has built together with the country of Ecuador, a major hydroelectric project in Ecuador. There's more than one. Go ahead to the next. Here's another. This is Fushun, roughly. Rejuvenation, the name of it. It's China's first totally domestically produced, designed, engineered, and produced high-speed rail, which is now running on the routes, particularly the starting with the Beijing to Shanghai run, 350, 400 kilometers an hour speeds. You know, you now have in China 24,000 kilometers of high-speed rail. That will soon be 36,000 kilometers of high-speed rail in 5 years or so. I want to mention very briefly here, try to make a point about the difference in terms of how we're going to have to transform our way of thinking in terms of economics. We have to think big, but then the question is, well, where does the money come from? If we're going to think big, how do we finance it? Well, if you take the last period since the 2008 financial crash, the U.S. has created approximately $15 trillion in debt. $15 trillion. The largest chunk of that is corporate financial engineering. It went to corporations buying back their own stock to boost the value of their stock. You know, I'm ExxonMobil. I have some cash. I buy my stock. My stock goes up. You know, so that's good for my stockholders, and that's good for the executives whose pay is based in part on how much on the valuation, right, of the stock market of their company stock. U.S. corporations have doubled their debt since the 2008 crash. Doubled it. By now, it's more than doubled through financial engineering. That's the term used in the community. Not physical engineering, financial engineering. We don't build anything. We engineer a lot of things in our mind, but you know. But what was China doing in this period? China, in this period of time, roughly speaking, created about the same amount of debt. By the way, the government debt of China, if I remember, is roughly equivalent to about $4 trillion. The U.S. debt is, what, $17 trillion now? I may be behind the times. But China's national debt is very low. But corporations in China, state-owned corporations, went into debt. There's 22 or so large SOEs. State-owned enterprises. They went into debt. What did they do with this debt? With the money, they borrowed this money, they went into debt. What did they do? They built, for example, 24,000 kilometers of high-speed rail. You know, they built power plants. They built, you know, a modern platform, infrastructure platform, you know, that's the best in the world. And it's still being developed. So what did they have for their debt? They have real wealth, physical wealth, right? Which realizes that debt that was emitted to finance those projects, right? Creating in the process millions of jobs, tax-paying jobs. All of it was done through companies that made profits and so forth in this massive expansion of the economy. And in the process, they created those corridors for increasing further economic development of China, or Pakistan, as the case may be, in the process. Right? Ideas flow, goods flow across China, you know, with a rapidity that obviously was not there before. The benefit to the people is enormous. Go on to the next. And I'll conclude. Guess what this is? Some may know, I don't give it away. What is this? This is the train station, the main train station in Beijing. All right? Those little fine little lines going off, the noodles going off there to the right and left, those are the train tracks going off. This is, I mean, just to give you a sense of the scale of what's going on there. go on to the next. But they're doing the same thing in Kenya, right? And in Ethiopia and elsewhere. They're building rail, electrified rail and so forth. Now this isn't Fuxing, this isn't high-speed rail yet, but that'll come along. This moves people and freight, right? And it moves it and it cuts it, the time of transportation to a fraction of what it was. Which means, among other things, food can be moved, right, that otherwise would spoil, and so forth. Going to the next. And that's just a map of the of what they're planning, what they built into Nairobi, but what they're planning to build on into South Sudan and south into Rwanda and Burundi and so forth. And ultimately, you know, China now, China has reached agreements with the African Union. They're going to link all the capitals of Africa, you know, with highways and rail. You know, and some places in Africa, to get from one place to another, you've got to fly from that country to Paris and then connect a flight back to the other locale in Africa. So Africa is going to be integrated as a collaborative effort among African nations and China. This is the question of integration, connectivity. This is what's shaping up. And with it comes a rising lifespan, right? A decrease in mortality rates, increased potentials for education, and the rest. Go on for the next. And this is, I think I'll just conclude with this so we have time for questions, but this is the largest project now being proposed. You can see the size of it. I mean, remember, Africa, you could put India, the United States, China, and other nations into Africa and not fill it up. The size of it is enormous. Okay, this is the scope of the Trans-Aqua project, which will move water from tributaries from the Congo, about 4% of the water, north to refill Lake Chad, which is now drawing out and threatening the lives of 30 million people. It's also spreading terrorism. Boko Haram, this is the area in which Boko Haram has taken root. But to reverse this process, to refill Lake Chad, to roll back the Sahara Desert, this is the Trans-Aqua project, which now the Italian government has just announced they're funding a new, updated engineering design program for this project, and then they'll move forward. China Power, that built the Three Gorges Dam, is the major company from China involved in this. And the engineering is done by an Italian firm, Bonafica. So this is still on the drawing boards, but there's just been a conference of the countries in the Chad Basin region, which, as you can see, takes in a lot of countries, and there was agreement there that this is now the only way to go. This is the kind of, think of, you know, what we heard about, oh, there's too many people in Africa, all those starving people in Africa. Well, the point is, the nations of Africa are now going to develop in collaboration with China. Now, we should be part of this. As Dr. Wong referenced, the U.S. and China should be partners in projects in third countries. We've got our engineering firms, Fluor, Bechtel, and so on and so forth. We've got capacity. GE Locomotive up there in Fort Worth produces locomotive engines. They're selling 200 of them to Canada. They're selling 500 of them to Uzbekistan, right? So it's not that you know, you can't move locomotives around the world, right? And so we have all kinds of, we sell more high-tech goods out of Texas than California does. We have manufacturing capacity already, but that could be tremendously expanded. The final thing is the financing. China wants to finance infrastructure in the United States. Starting with the Chinese Investment Corporation, which is the third largest sovereign wealth fund in the world, back in January of last year, the CEO at that time proposed that that they would be glad, they would be happy to move their money out of U.S. Treasury bonds, which draw almost zero interest, and move it into infrastructure projects in the United States. We have to create a mechanism for that. This is a return to Roosevelt, a return to the thinking of Lincoln, to create a national infrastructure bank, or a national bank, if you will, that would provide a place in which China could invest. China could help capitalize, or Chinese funds, companies and so forth, investment funds, could finance, could capitalize a bank dedicated to infrastructure projects in the United States. And of course, China could then bid on those projects. Chinese companies could bid on those projects alongside American companies. And so you could open up, right, what right now seems to be a bleak future, you know, where you wonder, you know, when's the next Harvey going to hit, right? We could transform this kind of bleak future, not only for ourselves, but for Puerto Rico, dealing with a transport crisis in New York City, Florida, on and on. We could, working hand in glove, we could leverage a return. It's ironic. Our debt, the debt we owe China, could return to the United States and finance the rebuilding of the United States. So that's what's on the drawing boards. And the tariff, we're not, you know, this is, I don't want to get into a, you know, these proposed tariffs back and forth and so on. So this can be simply the context in which this discussion now takes place, where we take a new approach. Okay, we're here, we're across the table from each other. How do we really solve this issue? Obviously, the way we do it, we expand production. We develop it. Development is the new name for peace. Martin Luther King would absolutely concur. Right? Development is the new name for peace. Let's figure this out. It can't be tit for tat. How do we move out of this box? How do we move the U.S. back into being a major producer? China finances infrastructure in the United States. Cement plants are going to have to be opened up. Steel mills are going to have to be opened up, et cetera, et cetera, on and on. Food production is going to have to increase. The country can prosper, as it did as we pulled ourselves out of the last depression. So let me conclude and thank you for your attention.
Very much. Well, that was very inspiring presentations from all of our distinguished speakers and guests here. And wow. So let me go ahead and I want to open it up for some brief discussion and questions in a second here. But I'm going to take just a moment to make another announcement, because people may not know, but the Schiller Institute has hosted a number of these educational forums. We've had a forum at Texas Southern University, Rice University, now here at the University of Houston, to educate the American people and educate people around the world on this beautiful new paradigm that's emerging throughout the world, an end to geopolitics, working together in the collaboration of nations. So I'm going to open the floor for questions here, but I do want to remind people we are really encouraging you to become a member of the Schiller Institute, to make sure you educate yourself by purchasing a copy of these very beautiful reports. This is the latest report, Extending the New Silk Road to the West Asia and Africa, a vision of an economic renaissance, as I said before. We also have the Silk Road report that has been translated into three different languages. It's in English and Chinese and Arabic. So definitely would encourage you to purchase these books, but also to share them with as many people as you know, and invite more people to come to these conferences. So with that, let me just open up the floor for questions for our speakers now. Yes, sir.
Yes, I have a question for the gentleman from China. Now that you're here in Houston, we have plans for a bullet train or high-speed rail And one of the things we see in Houston is we do not have the amount of rail lines that we have, let's say, in New York or Los Angeles and some of the other areas. And given our traffic issues, what would China's appetite be for investing in the infrastructure for the high-speed rail project and then maybe local rail lines? Thank you.
Thank you.
It's up to you.
Thank you so much for your question. Just as Wayne mentioned, China really...
I don't think we can hear you. Oh. I'm sorry, they don't have speakers over there. I'll hide some of them.
So thank you so much for your question, Matt. Just as Brian mentioned, China really enjoys a very mature technology of both train as well as the finance. To my knowledge, the Chinese relevant companies, parties, really like to do their part in building the high-speed railways in Texas, in California. But the biggest question right now is the environment within the United States. Technology, no problem. Finance, no problem. But security is the problem. The U.S. side does have the side fears. They would like to have the very tough and thorough national security check on the infrastructure building. Some people are just, you know, a little bit Cold War mentality. They think that China is trying to take a full control of the U.S. infrastructure, which will damage the U.S. national security, which is totally wrong. We have urged the relevant parties and the federal government to have an accurate understanding of China's real intentions about the taking part in the infrastructure of U.S. So far, I know that Chinese companies have taken a little bit, taken sort of part in the consultation within the preparations for the high-speed railway in Texas. But as to my knowledge, it's going to be a private business. It's still undergoing some procedures about the ecological considerations, some evacuations. So a lot of things, you know, are waiting to be done. So far, we have shown our sincerity, enthusiasm to take part in it. Right now, I think it is on the U.S. part to rethink about its national security check policy. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Shall I stay here? Also, just as a follow-up, you spoke about the high-speed rail. How would you feel about the metro area rail line, like extending Metro's rail, if you're familiar with our Metro rail? It's good, it's just not as extensive as perhaps it could be, and it would help alleviate some of the traffic issues here.
Yeah, thank you. I think for Texans, for the Texas people, they really enjoy the low price energy, gas and oil. I'm just wondering whether the express ways could have much market here. But in China, you know, it's a totally different picture between China, between Beijing and Shanghai. These are highly densely populated areas with the oil and gas of high price. We really need to develop facilitated express railways between the metropolises. Generally speaking, as Brian mentioned, for the second generation of high-speed railway rejuvenation, it will just take us only 4 hours from Beijing to Shanghai. The distance equals to that from Houston to Atlanta, just within 4 hours from a railway station to the other. So I think it's a good idea to think about it. Well, it is still depends on the local conditions, the environment, of course, something related with people's transportation habits, customs, something like that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm very pragmatic.
Okay. Yes.
Very illuminating. And the question one has to ask is, why would anybody be against this? You know, why would anybody be against this? And of course, there seems to be a lot of conflicting signals from the U.S. You know, first it seems to be welcoming aspects of it, then the tariff question. But I like if you could comment, because if you look at the London Economist, you know, the flagship publication of the British Empire, if you will, there is a real freak out about this with ugly, ugly characterizations of President Xi and the, you know, so all three nations here, including Pakistan, of course, have a history of breaking away in their own way from the British Empire. What's their conception of the Silk Road?
I don't think I'm in a position to tell the reasons, because I'm a strong favor for it. I remember that when I was learning English at the age of 9 years old, I learned the English proverb was saying, facts speak louder than words. China is always doing what it thinks in mind, what it has borne in mind. So right now, we should have a clear understanding of the stage of the situation in the world. In what time are we living? And shall we adopt to the trends of the times, or we just, you know, turn our back against it? China is not another Soviet Union. China is not Russia. China, of course, is not the United States. It's the biggest developing world, developing country in the world. China has its own traditions, cultures, different political systems. And what is the best for the Chinese people is that we can keep a steady and healthy development of our country. We would like to take the approach, share the principle of a shared development through coordination and collaboration. You know, that's the trend, because we are living in a totally different time. You know, right now we do have the hot issue of trade between our two countries. I think some people might be thinking about it. I'd like to elaborate on it, because maybe this gentleman might be interested in it as well. As for trade issues for our two biggest economies in the world, we don't think that the trade wars is the right way, the choice to solve the problem. As for trade deficit, the Chinese side really wants to address it through the way of addition instead of subtraction. By addition, we mean we would like to import more from the US side to reduce the deficit. Instead of attraction, subtraction, we mean that if the US side puts up more trade barriers, tariffs, it will not only hurt the Chinese interests, but also the interests of US consumers and also the world economy. And as for trade deficit, if you look at the whole picture. China enjoys the trade surplus in terms of goods trade. As for service sector, US side is enjoying a big surplus. And in the first session of the National People's Congress, which just concluded last month, the Chinese people has made it clear to the world that we will open even wider the service market. We will ease the market access of the service industry, which I think will provide even more business opportunities for the US enterprises. And if we look a little bit further, for the trade deficit, many of the exports from China to the United States are made by US companies in China. And China just to provide, you know, provides the assembly line, some parts, tech parts, are imported from countries and regions, countries like Japan, regions like Taiwan, to be gathered in like the Apple factory in Zhengzhou. So they will be assembled in Zhengzhou and exported to the US. The most profit goes to the Apple factory, to the US company, not to the Chinese side. But on the paper, it looks like China's trade surplus with the US. So it's a complicated picture. It's not so, it's unreasonable to blame China's trade surplus with US in a very narrow looking way. I mean, we would like to solve the problems. We do not encourage a huge trade surplus with the US. We would like to increase more, but it's market economy. For the trade issues, it's going to be dynamically balanced instead of planned balanced. I think the US consumers can have the same understanding as well. For Texas, we were expecting more export of LNG from Texas to China. We are also encouraging more export of beef from Texas to China. As for our consular regions, we are also encouraging more rice of Arkansas from Arkansas to China as well. So we are doing something very serious to reduce deficit. Some people in Washington are not feeling good about it. Yes, that's, I think that through negotiation and increasing the trade volume, we could settle the problems. But the real, what's at stake is look at how people, how the local people really feel about it. We must serve the fundamental interests of the peoples between China and US. That's my point. Thank you.
Let me just ask if our other speakers would like to comment or address the question that was just asked.
I'll make a comment.
Please.
I think I'd like to take I was very confident of my vocal cords. I think I'll take a more philosophical approach to the question that the gentleman in the back posed. Beyond numbers and figures, I think it's very important for all of us that share planet Earth to understand that our resources are shrinking as the years go by, and our challenges are increasing. And these are shared challenges. And I think Dr. Wong highlighted inequality, imbalance, and impoverishment as one of the three key challenges that all nations and all peoples all over the world face. It's just a difference in scales and sizes. And I think we need to move to an era where we move from competition to cooperation. And that paradigm shift needs to take place at leadership levels across nations and different regions of the world so that the challenges are minimized through cooperation and resources are maximized through cooperation. So that paradigm shift needs to take place. And then when that lens changes, then all these, you know, these conflicts or trade wars can be addressed in a more meaningful manner. And I think that is where we all need to, we need to think about it and reflect, and then bring about the change that the people who have elected their leaders expect them to do so. So that is my take on your points.
Goes right at the heart of your parable. You said, Dr. Wong, I think it's actions speak louder than words. Get some actions going. Action going. Okay, great. I saw, yes, please.
Well spoken for both. Thank you. Pakistan and Dr. Wong, recognizing that our whole planet is shifted. You know, we've shifted globally, governmentally, and recently, even though it hasn't been spoken openly, I like to articulate that we've seen that the Chinese yuan, for example, in China recently became gold-backed. So we do have to look at the whole perspective of shifting economic sphere has shifted, and yet we need to look at it from the perspective of the private sector. I would like to hear a little bit of input because we have shifted globally and financially. You mentioned the concerns of the U.S., but because a lot of wealth is going to be shifted very recently with all the economies, what is your wisdom that you would like to share for the private investors in terms of how we can collaborate at that level, because a lot of people will be able to move wealth of that dimension, to collaborate with China for the betterment of the whole planet and the globe? How can we collaborate as investors as opposed to the governmental level?
Thank you for your question. As for the private investors, first of all, I want to highlight that right now in China, the private enterprises, business, almost occupy half of the economy, the total. So it's the half sky. One is the sort of state-owned enterprises, the other is the private. You know, China's economy, the size of it is so big, it's very significant to rethink about the figure. And another one from the private investors' point of view, I think that they still have a very bright future in regard of the China-US cooperation in future. Especially at the regional and subnational level, China's private investors are so interested in, you know, US market. Last month, I took part in the South by in Austin, and I found that there were more and more Chinese investors from the private sectors taking part in the South by. They were not only, you know, displaying their technologies like Alibaba, WeChat, Huawei, they're also demonstrating their strong will to make the investment here in Houston, in Texas. In the coming May, we will be holding the third conference on cooperation of innovation between China and the U.S. right here in Houston. We have strongly encouraged the enterprise private sector investors from both countries to take part in it. And in the coming November, there will be the first international exposition on import to China in Shanghai, which is to be being held by the MOFCOM, Ministry of Commerce, together with the Shanghai Municipal Government. So it's going to be the very first one. It's going to be the very first one focused on the import from the outside world, which showcases China's strong will to increase its import and investment from the outside world. So madam, if you are interested, I strongly advise you to take a look at it. Thank you.
Council General Faruqi, Faruqi has to leave, and I'd just like to, for everyone to give her a round of applause.
Ask for some final comments from the speakers here, and then we can just have a little bit of time to have some dialogue briefly afterwards and to make sure people have a chance to go to the back. So again, why don't we have some final comments here, and then we can talk more afterwards.
And we can talk out in the hallway as well,
yes.
Once we're pushed out. Thank you very much for coming today. We have much work to do, and I hope in terms of my remarks that I hope I kind of connected the big wheel to the little wheel, that in terms of Houston itself, thinking outside the box is absolutely critical. And Houston, including the private sector, has so much to gain from collaboration with China, in terms of Chinese investment here, but also As Dr. Wong mentioned, the upcoming Shanghai exposition in November, I believe it is, which was announced. It's not something newly announced. President Xi Jinping announced it at the time of the Belt and Road Summit that this was being held. So China is very serious on importing from the United States into China. That's not an empty phrase, and I want to underscore that. So let me just leave it, I think, at that.
I think there might be no better comments than Brian's. I'd like to just say a few words about my experience. I just came to Houston 9 months ago, and I accompanied the Mayor Turner to visit China last November. I believe that my mission here is not only introduce China to Texans to the southern U.S., but also introduce Texas, Houston to China as well. So I will do my duty, I will serve my function. I really believe that at the regional level, subnational level, there are huge potentials for our future cooperation. I think that I firmly believe there should be a bright future between Texas and China. Thank you.
So again, I'd like to thank our speakers. I would like to thank all of you here today for taking time out of your busy schedules to realize how important this forum is. Please, it was recorded. We will have it up on the International Schiller Institute site. And thank you again for coming. Everyone have a good afternoon.